I'm so glad to introduce our young and dynamic speaker today, Dr. Rahul Mansingh Kadam. He's a lead consultant in Department of Neonatology and Pediatrics, Yashoda Hospital, Somajuguda, Hyderabad. So he has done his MBBS from Government Medical College, Kolhapur. He is DNB in Pediatrics and he has done his fellowship from Surya Hospital, Mumbai. So he was a consultant for 2 years in Goa, in Apollo Hospital, and last before joining Yashoda Hospital, he was a consultant for 5 years in Lotus Hospital. Now he is a renowned faculty for state and national conferences, and he has 10 publications and 5 chapters. So I'll not waste much of the time, and the session is over to you, Rahul sir.
Thanks, Amol, for kind words. I will start sharing my and just let me know whether it is clear or not. My slides are there. Anybody, please?
How was it, ma'am?
My slides are visible,
sir. Your slides are visible, but your voice, you are not audible, sir.
Okay,
you can check audio.
Am I audible?
No, sir, not yet.
I'm on mute only. Still not audible?
Now you are audible, sir. Now you are audible. Yeah.
Yeah. Now I'll start sharing my slides. Yeah. Slides are there and I'm audible. Let us start.
Yes, you are audible. Let us start, sir.
Yeah. So, very good evening to one and all, and greetings from Hyderabad. At the outset, let me thank the organizing committee and especially Mirgunde sir for inviting me.
Go ahead, sir.
No, slides are not. Slides are changing now?
Yeah, yes. Slides are changing.
Yeah. Okay. So, most of us must be familiar with this place. I started my journey in 2001 over here, and I have a lot of fond memories from Kolhapur. I have been faculty to many conferences, but this one is special for me because I feel like I'm at home. The topic which is given to me is the role of point of care ultrasound.
किस ग्रुप पे है किस पे यार
एवरीबॉडी महेश
क्या केयर वर्कर का 100 का डेटा भी हो गया नहीं छोड़ दूंगा 100 का डेटा
महेश
जय सर को भी जाता
सर एक मिनट क्लिक होत नाही त्यांच्या नावाच्या पुढे
Now the topic allotted to me is role of point of care ultrasound in neonatology. The idea about this talk is to provide you people insight about the scope of point of care ultrasound in NICU, and I'm not going to talk in detail about how to perform different scans. So with advances in technology, the ultrasound machine has become handheld now, and if we use it not for the diagnosis but as a part of physical assessment in our daily routine, it has become a visual stethoscope of 21st century. Now, point of care ultrasound. It is an ultrasound examination performed at the point of care, that is bedside, by the primary care physician, and the purpose of this is to clarify uncertain findings of the physical exam, to identify important conditions in the context of unwell patient, and to provide image guidance to us for success and safety of procedures in acute care settings. Now, now functional echo is also part of a point of care ultrasound. This is a limited echo by neonatologists to address a specific clinical question. It can be used as an adjunct to or extension of a clinical examination. It helps assess a structural heart disease. It does not replace formal echo by a pediatric cardiologist, and any abnormality noted should be confirmed by a pediatric cardiologist. Now, why we require a point of care ultrasound? So this is earliest imaging possible. It is safe, radiation free, reliable, and quick. It can be easily performed at bedside. We can do a number of ultrasounds without any adverse effects. So it is useful for follow-up of high-risk patients. It is cost-effective, and there is no risk associated with sedation and transport, which is the case in case of CT scans and MRIs. Now, if you look at point-of-care ultrasound in neonatology, we have been doing brain ultrasound for more than 30 years. We have been doing functional echoes for more than 10 years. Recently, we have started doing lung abdomen ultrasounds, and we have started putting ultrasound-guided lines. Most of the NICUs in Australia and New Zealand, they have at least one neonatologist who is competent in performing point-of-care ultrasound. And there, it has become the integral part of their neonatal teaching program. So let us start with our first case. This was a 27-week preterm, 800 grams baby, delivered by emergency LSTS in vivo abruptio placentae. There was a moderate RDS, and SS score was around 5. We commenced on a bubble CPAP with a support of 6 centimeters, 30%, and we gave a first dose of surfactant by Ensure method. Baby remained stable for around 6 hours, and after 6 hours, there was sudden worsening with increasing oxygen requirements, and we ventilated this baby. So what would be our thought process? Definitely, we will think whether we need to give a second dose of surfactant. So we also thought that we should give a second dose of surfactant. As a protocol for babies less than 28 weeks, we do a brain ultrasound at around 6 to 8 hours. So before proceeding for surfactant, we did a brain ultrasound, and what we found was there was a massive grade 4 bleed on left side. So point of care ultrasound here helped us to find out the cause of deterioration is grade 4 IVH and not RDS. So we could counsel this family about the short-term and long-term prognosis, and they opted for a palliative care. So point-of-care ultrasound will help us to make a informed decisions. So neurosonogram, it helps us to diagnose and grade intraventricular hemorrhage. Grade 1 IVH is the bleed in germinal matrix hemorrhage. Grade 2, the bleed will enter into the ventricle. Grade 3, there will be active dilatation. Grade 4, the bleed will extend to the periventricular white matter. This is how the bleed will appear on the sagittal views. And whom and when to screen for intraventricular hemorrhage. So this is a suggested screening protocol from one of my write-ups for upcoming book of NNF. So In short, any babies who are less than 32 weeks and less than 1500 grams, we should do brain ultrasound. And for the babies who are more than 32 weeks, if they are risk factors, then you should do brain ultrasound to screen for intraventricular hemorrhage. Now, neurosonogram not only helps us to diagnose the intraventricular hemorrhage, but it also helps to follow these patients for complications like post-hemorrhagic hydrocephalus. And with ultrasound, we can measure ventricular sizes, and that will help us for early intervention in these babies. So remember, ventriculomegaly or increase in the ventricular size on ultrasound occurs way ahead the clinical increment in the head circumference. So again, in these babies, we can measure something called as a resistive index with the help of ultrasound, and that also will help us for early intervention. So if Levine index exceeds more than 4 mm over the baseline, or if anterior horn width is more than 4 mm, or thalamic occipital distance is more than 26 mm, or third ventricular width is more than 3 mm, these are all the indications of a CSF removal. So just by doing ultrasound in these patients, we can decide when to remove the CSF. Similarly, resistive index, if it is more than 0.9, or if it rises by 30% after compression over antefrontal nail, that is also an indication for CSF removal. So point of care ultrasound in babies with IVH and hydrocephalus will help us to monitor them and to decide for early intervention. Now look at this case. This was a term baby, uneventful antenatal period, developed a respiratory distress after 3 hours of life. There was a systolic murmur on examination. Echo showed features of pulmonary hypertension with dilated RA and RV. We started this baby on milrinone, but there was no satisfactory response. So this was unexplained cardiac fever. And in this baby, we did a neurosonogram. And what we found that there was a cystic lesion in third ventricular area having a mass effect. And then we put a color Doppler, and you can see nicely there was a swell effect showing a dilated feeding and draining vessel. So this was nothing but a vein of gallon malformation, and which we could pick up early because of a brain ultrasound. And this baby required endovascular embolization, and after that this baby improved. So whenever you see a cystic lesion on brain ultrasound, always put a color Doppler. Now in babies with hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, brain ultrasound will help us for early prognosis decisions. So if you can see on a gray scale, you will see hyperintensities in basal ganglia and thalamic regions. And with increasing severity of the illness, they will become more intense. And if you do a Doppler of anticerebral artery, in initial stages, you will see there will be increased diastolic flow because of impaired autoregulation, and RI will be less. And once the asphyxia continues, the diastolic flow will go down and the RI will rise. So resistive index of less than 5 or resistive index of more than 9 will indicate a poor outcome. So usually these babies will be sick and they won't be ideal candidate for MRI. They won't be stable for doing MRI. So by doing the brain ultrasound, we can make out which babies are likely to have a poor prognosis, and we can counsel families accordingly. Now, after looking the role of brain ultrasound in point of care NICU, let us move to the next case. It's a 30-week preterm who was 1,000 grams, had RDS, was given surfactant by Insure technique, and then we put on the CPAP. Baby remained stable for 48 hours, and the CPAP support was very minimal, PEEP of 5 centimeters, and FI2 was hardly 25%. At 48 hours, this baby had a worsening RD, intermittent desaturation episodes with increasing respiratory requirements, and had tachycardia. We did a neurosonogram this time, it was normal, and the sepsis screen of the baby was negative. So what is next? What can be the next possibility? So we did a functional echo in this baby, and this is what we found. You can see here, there was a large PDA with left to right shunt. And now the dilemma for us was whether to manage this baby conservatively with fluid restriction or whether to close this PDA medically. And the functional echo is going to answer this question. So PDA assessment we do in a PDA view, that is a modified high parasternal view. There we can see PDA nicely. You can see here. You can see PDA nicely as a connection between pulmonary artery and descending aorta, and you should measure it on a grayscale towards the pulmonary end. Then you put the color and you can see a nice left to right shunt, and then you put a continuous Doppler and you see for the velocity and flow pattern in the PDA. So these are the flow patterns what we usually see in PDA, and whenever the pattern is of a growing type or a pulsatile type, it is more likely a hemodynamically significant PDA which may warrant a treatment. Now after looking at the basic characteristics of PDA, we should look for the signs of pulmonary overcirculation. So we should see for elevated LA to aortic foot ratio, we should see increased LV output, and we should see for increased LPA end diastolic velocity. And then we should look for signs of systemic hypoperfusion. So we can see a Doppler in the descending aorta, anterior cerebral artery, and the celiac artery, where we can see for absent end diastolic flow or a reversal of end diastolic flow. So these are the markers what we get on hemodynamic assessment of PDA. So if PDA is small, we should monitor this PDA. If the PDA is medium, this is the PDA. This is the PDA which is which requires a close monitoring and conservative management in the form of fluid restriction. Whereas a large PDA is a PDA which is hemodynamically significant and we should close it medically. So coming to our case, there was a large PDA which was 3.5 mm with left to right shunt, and there was a pulsatile pattern. There was a pulmonary overcirculation. LPA end diastolic velocity was 0.5, LA to aortic root ratio was 2.2, and LV output was almost more than 500. And the Doppler of descending aorta showed a reversal of end diastolic flow. So this was a hemodynamically significant PDA. We gave endomethacin to this baby, and another 2 days we could extubate this baby. So again, by timely functional echo, we could decide about this management of this baby and we could save this baby. So now we no more diagnose PDA in NICU, rather we monitor the PDA. For the babies who are more than 28 weeks, we should follow symptomatic approach. What I mean by, once they are symptomatic, we should screen for PDA and we should treat it if it is hemodynamically significant. Whereas for the babies who are less than 28 weeks, we follow early targeted approach. What I mean by, we do a first echo in these babies by 6 to 12 hours, and we keep on monitoring them every 6 to 12 hourly for first 72 hours, and we treat the PDA which is only hemodynamically significant. Now, moving on to the next case, it was a term 40 weeks baby, 2.6 kilos, delivered by emergency LSCS in view of fetal distress. There was a meconium stain liker. Baby had a respiratory distress soon after the birth, was put on the oxygen by prongs, and was referred to us at 10 hours of life. So when we received baby had a severe RT, Downey score was almost 7, and we ventilated a baby straight away, and baby was requiring very high support. You can see like MAP requirement was 12 and FiO2 requirement was almost 80%, and there was a metabolic and respiratory acidosis. Again, neurosonogram was done, which was normal. So what is next? So based on the history, meconium stain liker, worsening respiratory distress, we thought of a pulmonary hypertension, and we did the functional echo, and this is what we found. There was a massive TR, and then we calculated PA pressures by this formula, and the PA pressures were almost 45. So this is a severe pulmonary hypertension. Okay. Assess a baby with a PPHN. Next, you should see for whether there is any right to left shunt at PDA or PFO. In our case, there was no extra pulmonary shunt, so basically this was intrapulmonary shunting. Next, you should look for interventricular septum morphology. In a normal heart, you will see a nice globular left ventricle. In moderate pulmonary hypertension, the interventricular septum will become flat and LV will look like a D shape. Whereas in severe cases, there will be bowing of septum into the left ventricle, and the left ventricle will appear like a crescent or crescentic. So in our patient, you can see like RARV where massively dilated. You can see like interventricular septum was going to the left, and you can see the IVC was dilated and there was hardly hardly any variation in the IVC diameter with respiration. Next, in PPHN, you can do quantitative measurements also of RV function, which requires a bit of expertise. So in our patient, it was a severe pulmonary hypertension. We put a baby on a high frfrequency ventilator. We started a sildenafil infusion and we started a low dose epinephrine infusion. Over the time, this baby improved. So this is how we can monitor and decide about the treatment for babies who have pulmonary hypertension with a functional echo. Now, usually in a compensatory shock, we will get a normal blood pressure and cardiac output will be low. Whereas in cases of hyperdynamic circulation like sepsis or PDA, blood pressures can be low, but there can be high cardiac output. So neonatal shock is always a diagnostic dilemma, and shock in neonate is not equal to hypotension. That we know, whenever there is a hypotension, whatever is the etiology, we are in the uncompensated phase and hardly we can do anything. So for any sick neonate, we should do a functional echo to assess for volume, cardiac output and myocardial function. And these three parameters will help us to recognize compensated shock early, and accordingly we can do early treatment. Now, volume assessment we usually do by eyeballing of the ventricles or measuring the IVC collapsibility index. We know the formula Dmax minus D minus minus minimum divided by Dmax into 100. So whenever IVC collapsibility index is more than 50%, it usually indicates that fluid volume is less and we can give fluids. But when the maximum diameter of IVC is more than 8 millimeters and the collapsibility index is less than 50%, that means the volume is normal. And when the maximum diameter is more than 8 millimeters and there is no collapse of IVC with respiration, that what does it mean? That central venous pressure is high and probably it is RV filled hypervolemia. However, this volume assessment by echo is reliable in a pediatric age group, but in newborns it is not reliable. That's why, so functional echo is not a good tool in newborns to assess volume. So we should not rely on IVC collapsibility index and eyeballing of the ventricles for volume assessment in newborns. Rather than, we should look for the cardiac output measurements and the myocardial function. So we can easily measure left ventricular output and right ventricular output with functional echo. And usually the cardiac output assessment in first 48 hours, whenever there are shunts, may not be reliable. Whenever there's a PD or PFO, LV output or RV output may not correspond to the cardiac output. In such a cases, you should measure the SVC flow, that is the flow in the superior vena cava. Again, that requires a bit of expertise, but it correlates well with a blood flow to the brain in first 48 hours of life. So there are published reference values for the systemic flow velocities for preterm and term babies with age cutoffs like few hours, 24 hours, day 2 and till day 14. And this we can use to determine whether the systemic velocities for our patient are in normal range or whether they are low or whether they are high. So that we can make out whether it is a low cardiac output state or whether it is a high cardiac output state. Similarly, we can measure a myocardial function. So systolic myocardial function of left ventricle, we can measure by calculating fractional shortening. I'm not going to go into details of this. So fractional shortening normally in the newborns is around 20 to 40. And we can measure RV systolic function by calculating TAPC. TAPC is nothing but tricuspid annular pansystolic exertion. So TAPC usually should be 5 to 10 mm. Again, we can measure a diastolic function of a myocardium by doing a mitral wall and tricuspid wall Doppler and looking for the E as to A ratio. So whenever you put a Doppler across a mitral wall or tricuspid wall, you are going to get such a pattern. The first one is an E wave and second one is an A wave. So E wave is nothing but passive diastolic blood flow, and A wave is nothing but flow because of atrial contraction. And in a preterm baby, if EA ratio is less than 0.6, and in a full-term baby, if a EA ratio is less than 0.7, it indicates diastolic filling abnormality. So with a functional echo, by looking at a volume status, cardiac output, and myocardial function, we can recognize onset shock early, and then we can have a individualized approach based on the etiology to treat this shock. So no routine preload augmentation for all newborns. We can select inotropes based on our hemodynamic assessment, and the old school thought of fluid bolus and dopamine and dobutamine is not applicable to all newborns. So one size does not fit all. We should treat neonatal shock based on the hemodynamic assessment with the different measures. Now, going ahead with the next case, this is a case during my fellowship. In fact, this case taught me that I should learn a point of care ultrasound. So this was a 26 weeks preterm, had a respiratory distress syndrome, was ventilated for 3 days, then was put on a CPAP. There was an umbilical venous lining C2 for parenteral nutrition. He was stable on CPAP till 5th day. On 5th day of life, he suddenly worsened with a respiratory distress. He was pale and developed apneic episodes. Immediately, we intubated and ventilated. We did a neurosonogram that was normal. That time, we were not aware of how to do functional echo. And luckily, our cardiologist was in the unit doing the routine echoes. And we just requested him to screen this baby. And we did a echo. And what we found out was there was a massive pericardial effusion. You can see nicely there was a massive pericardial effusion. Our umbilical venous line had entered the right atrium, had pierced the right atrial wall, and there was a massive pericardial effusion. So immediately we did a pericardiocentesis and we pulled out this IV venous line, and we could extubate this baby in the next 24 hours. So dramatic response was there, and just by timely functional echo, we could recognize this effusion and we could save this baby. So you can easily recognize pericardial effusion in a plaques view. I'm not going to go into details of views. In a plaques view, where you will see, this is the descending aorta, where you will see the pericardial effusion will be anterior to descending aorta. If you see effusion here, posterior to descending aorta, that is pleural effusion. That is how you differentiate pleural and pericardial effusion. And here you can do measurements also. If the measurement is more than 1 centimeter anteriorly, and if it is more than 2 centimeter posteriorly, that means it is a large effusion. Fluid volume is almost 300 ml. So this is how we can recognize the pericardial effusion. Now, let us look at the next case. This was a term neonate referred to us at 48 hours with sudden onset respiratory distress, an eventful antenatal period, Downey score 5, Roux-Mayer SAT square 85%. We did a chest X-ray, which was unremarkable. We couldn't make out anything in chest X-ray. So what we did next is we just did a lung ultrasound, and this is what we found. So those who are doing lung ultrasound, they may be knowing what this is. This is called as a barcode sign. You can see here. So this is entirely looks like a barcode, and this was a pneumothorax. We drained, we did a needle drain, and baby improved drastically. So just by doing a bedside lung ultrasound, we could find out that this baby had a pneumothorax, and we could do immediate drainage. So just to show you how a normal lung appears on a lung ultrasound, you will see the brightest structure as the pleural line. It should be very thin, and then you see the equidistant A lines. And in real image, you will see there is a sliding movement at the pleura. Visceral and parietal pleura, they will slide on each other like this. And this, what we call it, is a shimmering, or it will appear as if ants are marching. We call it as an ant marching. And this is what we call it as an A profile. So that is a normal lung. So normal lung is thin pleural line along with lung sliding along with A lines. And if you put an M mode across, you see this pattern, what we call it as a seashore sign or a sandy beach appearance, where you have a brightest structure as a pleura. Superficial structures are the motionless. They will appear like a horizontal line. And down you have a lung, which will appear like a grains, which indicates the moving lung. So that's what we call it as a seashore sign. So this is how the normal lung will appear on a lung ultrasound. Now,
sir, sorry to interrupt. You have 5 minutes, sir.
believe me, we can diagnose pneumothorax within a minute on lung ultrasound. We can just put M mode and we can see barcode sign on the lung ultrasound, which is very specific. And then you see something called as a lung point, which shows like this is a normal lung with a seashore sign and there is a barcode appearance. So that is 100% specific and you can diagnose pneumothorax very easily. Now you can diagnose RDS. You will see bilateral white lung appearance with no spared areas, and you will see the thickened irregular pleural lines with subpleural consolidation. You can make out transient tachypnea on lung ultrasound, and particularly in the late preterms, by ultrasound you can distinguish between RDS and transient tachypnea of newborn very easily, because in transient tachypnea there won't be any pleural line abnormalities, whereas in RDS you will see the thick pleura. You can see different patterns of pneumonia on lung ultrasound: consolidation, hypertension of the lung, fractal sign, or air bronchograms. You can diagnose pleural effusion easily on lung ultrasound. And lung ultrasound, it has a higher diagnostic accuracy than physical examination and chest X-ray combined in most of the lung conditions. Now, lung ultrasound can help us for a surfactant therapy as well. This is a recent publication in July 2020, where they divided babies in two groups. In one group, they did ultrasound at 1 hour. Other group, they was a control. And first group, they gave surfactant based on the ultrasound findings. I'll just go a bit faster. And it is very easy. They scored lung, they did ultrasound in upper anterior, lower anterior, and lateral area, and they just gave the points for the findings. So, and based on that, they did a score. And those babies who had a score more than 8, they gave surfactant. And those babies who received lung surfactant based on lung ultrasound score had lesser oxygen requirements and had a better oxygenation after treatment. So they had a reduced oxygen exposure. So now lung ultrasound we can use to guide surfactant therapy as well. Again, we can assess lung recruitment with lung ultrasound. And people have started using recruitment manure, lung ultrasound guided recruitment manure in ARDS patients as well. You can confirm the ET tube placement. You can see here, this is a normal ET in place, and you can see the colac esophagus in posteriorly. That is what we call it as a bullet sign. When there is an esophageal placement of ET tube, you will see something called as a double trachea appearance. Similarly, by doing suprasternal aortic view, you can decide whether ET tube is placed correctly or not. You should measure a distance from the outer arch of aorta to the ET tube, and it should be between 0.5 to 1 centimeter. Here you can see that ET tube has gone inside, so that is a deeply placed ET tube. Again, we have a data for Indian babies, preterm and term, about this distance between ET tube and aorta, and accordingly we can avoid X-rays to confirm the position of a ET tube. Again, ultrasound will help us to confirm the position or placement of UVC, and UVC should be either in the ductus venosus or in the inferior vena cava near right atrium. So when you compare X-ray with ultrasound, the UVC which appears properly placed on X-ray, only in 30% of the cases on ultrasound you find that it is correctly placed. So ultrasound will help you to place UVC correctly. You can see here a correctly placed UVC. Now, ultrasound in cases of NEC will help us to pick up stage 2 and stage 3 NEC earlier, and so that you can intervene early. There are certain findings which you see. You will see thickened bowel, you can see intramural gas. You can see here there is a leak and the gas as white dots. You can see like portal vein gas will appear like a hyper echoic or bright punctate lesions in liver shadow. And with progressing NEC, you will see the thinning. Now, if you put a color Doppler, you will see the hyperemic valvuli, and with early phases of NEC, you will see the increased vascularity with the thickening of the bowel loops. This is a slide which shows like how the NEC progresses. Initially, you will have a normal bowel thickness with a normal vascularity. In initial phases of NEC, there will be increased thickness with increased vascularity, and slowly the thickness will decrease and the vascularity will decrease. You can see the bowel is thin and there is no vascularity. So this is impending necrosis and ischemia. This is how you can pick up the stage 2 or stage 3 NEC earlier. So in any patient who is unwell or collapsed in NICU, you perform a cardiac ultrasound to look for pericardial effusion, to look for volume, to look for contractility, to calculate cardiac output, to look for PDA, and to look for pulmonary hemodynamics. You perform a brain ultrasound to look for intraventricular hemorrhage and perform Doppler. Perform lung ultrasound to rule out pneumothorax, effusion, or consolidations. Perform ultrasound to check line positions or any line related complications, and perform abdominal ultrasound to look for any signs of NEC. So if you didn't get anything till now, this slide is very important. Any collapse newborn in NICU, you should do these 5 point of care ultrasounds in NICU. My take homes would be, point of care ultrasound is a very useful tool in the hand of neonatologists. It helps us understand underlying hemodynamic derangements in a better way, plays a vital role in decision making in acute care settings. Lung ultrasound particularly has a very high diagnostic accuracy for different neonatal conditions. And the most importantly, point of care ultrasound is not here to replace the role of pediatric cardiologist and radiologist in neonatology. I would end my presentation with this beautiful quote. The illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. So my friends, keep calm and learn scan. These are few of the glimpses of our previous workshops, and this is a major miss this year. Hope this pandemic will get over soon and we will kickstart with workshops. Happy Diwali to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a very nice and excellent comprehensive presentation, sir. So you had touched many areas, although it's a very vast topic, and covering this topic in 30 minutes is really it's a skill, sir. And you touched all the aspects of neonatology where ultrasound or echo can be helpful to the pediatricians. So you had rightly told us about the case-based scenarios and how ultrasound or echo helps in decision making, and how initial screening, a radiologist and cardiologist are important, but they are not all the time available. So for decision making, definitely ultrasound, point of care ultrasound, and echo are really helpful in neonatology. Thank you very much, sir.